Esther and Rose will be leading us in our song service this morning, and so we are ready to proceed. Esther, go ahead and lead out.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I'm so happy that we're all here together, and I can't wait till we can actually be together, but we're very, very, very thankful for this method of communication. Go ahead, Mom.
Our next song, Shall We Gather at the River?
Yeah.
Pastor, you are muted.
At this time, Dan will share with us the announcements and welcome.
Well, welcome everybody and happy Sabbath. You all can hear me, right? Okay. All right. We just had a couple of announcements that I wanted to tell everybody. Just so you know, Pastor is taking a three-week working vacation, which means for the next 3 weeks, you'll need to call the elders if you have any concerns or anything like that. But he's going to be around and he's going to need some help. So you all have a chance to get out and get some exercise this next 3 weeks because he's going to be out working on the garden and the field. So if anybody wants to help him, you'd be glad. I'm sure he'd accept any help to clean up. We got stuff we need to do around the front of the building and weeds to pull. And I don't know what all he's got planned for out there. But anyway, if you have some time this week and you want to go out, give him a call and find out when he'll be there or what he wants you to do. And well, I'm sure he'll keep you busy.
Let me just break in there for a moment. Yeah, I'm going to have all kinds of fun in the garden. And I'm going to invite you to join. It's kind of selfish of me to keep it all to myself. And so you're welcome to join me and, you know, to just clean up around there and make sure that we are making the surroundings to the church beautiful. And so starting tomorrow morning, I will be there. We do have a meeting tomorrow morning, the elders at 9 o'clock, right? And I have another meeting at 10, but by 11 o'clock, I should be there.
Okay, and then another announcement for another outing is this afternoon at 3 o'clock, we're having a gathering at the Nature Center and whoever wants to come can go for a walk. We'll break up into small groups so we don't violate any of the small group laws or whatever. But everybody's welcome, 3 o'clock at the Nature Center, and we'll just kind of play it by ear, break up into small groups and go for walks. So you're all welcome to come to that as well. I think that's all the announcements I have. Everybody have a good Sabbath.
Our last song is We Have This Hope. And
we have this hope that burns within our hearts, warm in the coming of the Lord. We have this faith that Christ alone imparts, faith in the promise of his word. We believe the time is here when the nations far and near shall awake and shout and sing, Hallelujah, Christ is near. We have this hope that burns within our hearts, hope in the coming of the Lord. We are united in Jesus Christ our Lord. We are united in his love for the waiting people of the world, people who need our Savior's love. Soon the heavens will open wide, Christ will come to claim his bride, all the universe will sing, Hallelujah, Christ is King.
Let's sing the last verse one more time, the second verse.
We are united in Jesus Christ our Lord. We are united in his love. Love for the waiting people of the world. People who need our Savior's love. Soon the heavens will open wide. Christ will come to claim his bride. All the universe will sing hallelujah, Christ is King. We have this hope, this faith in God's great love. We are united in Christ.
I want to welcome all of you to our church service this morning. Also, those of you who are now joining us right at this very second, you're joining us on the radio from around Wichita, and also we have a live transmission on YouTube right now. Again, welcome to our church service here at Three Angels Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're thankful that we have this opportunity to meet again. We don't know for how many more weeks we will need to meet. It could happen that we get together within a few weeks, but right now we want to make sure we take the right precautions, in as much as we don't want to have a situation where only a few are welcome. We'd like everyone to be welcome to church at the same time, and it's a little challenging to practice social distancing when you have 150 to 180 people in our sanctuary at this particular time. So just we'll just have to practice the patience of the saints, and we will eventually get together as a church family. But we are together. Right now, we are together. And so I'm thankful that you are here. And Esther Barrel will be leading us in, or will be sharing a children's story with us right now. There's almost a story within the story there, Esther, isn't there? You just, you were scheduled for today, but yeah, go ahead, share with us the story that you have.
I am so glad to be able to share a story with you this morning. I didn't know it was my turn to tell a story this morning. I just didn't know, but I'm so glad. I hope there's lots of children out there. And I know if any of you grown-ups are like me, I know that you love to have a story told to you too. So I have three stories for you today. And I hope my children are downstairs listening too, because the first one Peter asked me to tell, and that is one day the kids were out riding their bikes. And as any good mommy always warns their children, I warned my children, please be careful. Always watch for cars, be listening for cars. And if a car comes, get right off the road as quickly as possible. Well, we used to have, I haven't seen him in a long time, a big black dually pickup truck that would ride past our house very, very fast. And it always made me so scared, because there's lots of children on our street. And I was afraid that somebody would get hit. Well, it just so happened that this particular day, my children were outside riding their bikes in the street, and that big black dually pickup showed up, and he gunned his engine as if there were no children in the street and was racing down our street. And there my children are out in the road. Now, what would happen to my children if they ignored my warnings of getting off the street, of listening for cars? What would happen to my children? They would surely be squished. But my children, very quickly in their minds, they told me, they said a prayer because they knew they were in danger, because that person was not being safe. and they quickly got off the street just in time before he passed where they were. And we were just so grateful that they obeyed. I have another obedience story for you today. This happened probably around 30 years ago. Around 30 years ago, there was a little girl named Sarah. And Sarah loved her daddy so very much. She always listened to her daddy, and she had learned to obey right away, even if she didn't understand why. So Sarah, one day, she said, "Daddy, I need to run home real quick. Can I go cross the street and go to our house and go get something from the house?" And Daddy said, "Sure, you can run home. Just watch out for cars." Well, Sarah went to the street and she looked for cars, but she didn't see a huge semi that was coming toward her. And just as she was running across the street, her daddy looked up and saw that she was about to be hit by a semi truck as she was running across the street. And he yelled very quickly. He said, "Sarah, lay down." And Sarah did not understand why Daddy was telling her to lay down in the middle of the street, but she had learned to instantly obey. And so Sarah quickly laid down, and do you know that semi went right over her, one wheel on one side of her and one wheel on the other side of her, and she was completely safe. Had she not listened to her daddy, she would have died. She would have been hit by the semi. And it was so important for her life that she instantly obeyed her daddy, even though she didn't understand why Daddy was telling her to do such a strange thing. I have my third story today, and this one's from the Bible. Do you remember the story of when God told Abraham to take his only son, Isaac, and go and sacrifice him on the Mount Moriah? You know, that was a very strange thing that God asked Abraham to do, but he obeyed. He took his son, and even though he was very sad and he didn't understand what God was asking him to do, he obeyed and he went. But I think it's very wonderful that Isaac, when his daddy did tell him why they were on Moriah, why there wasn't a lamb to sacrifice, Isaac chose to obey his daddy, even if it meant losing his own life. And that seems like extreme obedience, doesn't it? It seems like extreme obedience. But his obedience has been a light and example for thousands of years. And we know that sometimes we may not understand. Of course, God intervened and saved the life of Isaac, but I bet Isaac was really thankful afterwards, and so was Abraham, that they chose to obey and then let God take care of the rest. And sometimes God may ask us to do something strange, or there may be something in the Bible that we don't quite understand, and it might not be to our liking, but God says to obey. And if we obey, God will surely bless us. And if we really are humbly walking for the Lord and are in danger of doing something we shouldn't, God will intervene and show us what we should do. So that was my message today. We should always obey our parents and always obey the Lord. And if we do those things, we can be safe.
Thank you, Esther, for sharing those stories with us. Marvin Marching will now be talking to us about our financial needs and the offering, which is also an act of worship. And Marvin, I think you're the one at this point that will be taking over the microphone.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, our offering today is for Adventist Community Services. Adventist Community Services provide disaster response services to assist individuals, families, and communities. They work with other people too, like Red Cross and Salvation Army to coordinate helping people. Some of those needs are for floods, hurricanes, tornadoes, fires, and earthquakes. One area Adventist Community Services is helping with now is assisting food pantries provide food for those in need during this COVID-19 pandemic. Adventist Community Services has given $1.5 million to the Conference in North American Division to assist food pantries. Three Angels Church has received $1,000 to help in our food pantry. As we give our tithe and offerings, let's support the offering today for Adventist Community Services so that they can continue helping those in need.
Thank you, Marvin. Marvin is the treasurer for the Three Angels Church, and so we appreciate this update from him and the appeal to continue giving. I just want you to be aware that for 2 months in a row, our giving has not been affected by the COVID-19 crisis. We appreciate the fact that God has put it on your heart to give, to return your tithes and to give your offerings. I will be leading the church in prayer at this time. And after I have prayed, the Mifuko family will be sharing special music with us. Let us pray. Our loving and kind Heavenly Father, we're just thankful for the fact that we have this Sabbath 24 hours time that we can, that you have set aside to spend in a special way with your people. Even though we spend time with you every day of the week, we have this special date with you, so to speak, and a special weekly holy time. And so, Father, I pray that as we gathered here, which is really the best part of the day when we can be together as a church family, that you will speak to our hearts through the message that will be shared in a few moments, that you will be with those that are struggling with illness, with pain, with hardship of any kind, and the people that are struggling emotionally or spiritually in our midst. Father, I just pray that you will be with those various needs and that your spirit will mightily work in the lives of people within our church, but also those in the community that are searching for truth, that are searching for you. Oh, Father, we just pray that your spirit will work actively through us and in the community so that we can truly be involved in spreading the good news to those around us. And Father, again, we want to lift up the speaker, Brian Barrow, that you will touch his lips, that what he shares will be relevant to each one of us. And Father, I know that the Holy Spirit can touch each one with a message that you want each of us to have. And so we thank you for that. And I pray for the world church gathered around the world today. We pray for the leaders of our country as well as the leaders of our church, that you will help every decision that is made will be a decision that will help further your kingdom, Father. Again, we're thankful that for all the health workers that are involved in protecting or helping those that have come down with the virus. But Father, there are many other illnesses people have. And so I pray that you will give wisdom to health workers, to physicians, nurses, etc., and protect them as well from the illnesses that might be debilitating. And Father, we just pray for your blessing on this day in Christ's name. Amen. And at this time, the Mifuko family will be leading us in the special music. Just a moment. I understand that. There we go.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay, very good. This morning we are going to sing the song speak about in the dark of the midnight, Lord, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Well, I'm corrected here. The title is "Till the Storm Passes Over." For some of you, if you know the song, please go ahead and sing with us.
In the dark of the midnight, have I oft hid my face, while the storm howls above me, and there's no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe, till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Many times Satan whispered, there is no need to try, for there's no end of sorrow, there's no hope by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll arise where the storms never dark in the sky. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. When the long night has ended and the storms come no more, let me stand in thy presence on the bright, peaceful shore, in that land where the tempest never comes. Lord, may I dwell with thee when the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Keep me safe till the storm passes by.
What a blessing. Thank you for that song. And Brian Byrell will now share the message that God has put on his heart for us. Go ahead, Brian.
Hi. I said I was muted still, but I am not muted anymore. It has been several months now since this message has been on my heart. I was planning to preach it back in December 28th. And many of you know that my mom's health was failing at that moment. And so I decided to go up and be with her, which reminds me, tomorrow is Mother's Day. This is not a Mother's Day sermon, but for those celebrating Mother's Day tomorrow, may you all have a happy Mother's Day and be with the, and also extend a prayer to those that are, have lost their mother like I have, that the Lord will be with you and give you peace in this time as the special music to the storm passes over. So this has been a message I've wanted to preach for a while. There was one time I was supposed to preach it in February, but I came down with influenza A, and so I couldn't preach it then. And then I was thinking, okay, Lord, I'm going to preach it in Kingman. I don't know. Doesn't matter where I'm going to preach it. I'm going to preach it. And COVID-19 happened and a stay-at-home order came about. And so I could not go to Kingman to preach it. And so today is going to be the sermon. And I ask you, who thought 2 months ago we would be on YouTube, the radio broadcast, and a virtual church service on Zoom? No, nobody thought 2 months ago that this would be the reality of today. What person thought that at the time that we closed our church 2 months ago, that that might have been the last time for a long time to give a church member a handshake or a hug? And things changed so rapidly. And people had fear rise in their hearts, and fear still exists. People may not be afraid of the virus, but people are afraid of the effects on the social and economic situation we are experiencing. There's a new norm. We took for granted the privileges we had just 2 months ago, that we can meet with each other and give each other hugs or handshakes if you don't like hugs. We could shop and get what we wanted, but not so now. We could visit and play board games and be social without the distancing, but not so now. We could do so many things 2 months ago that we can't do now. And how quickly it was taken away when we weren't aware of it disappearing. Many people long for social outings, as we're going to have this afternoon. But the more immediate social outings, as going to church and being able to have a church service in the church building and to welcome each other, seems so distant right now. And sometimes we may even feel as that it might be impossible. But God is good, and he will not leave us desolate. There will come a time, just not now. But the question is, when? So fast this has happened, and we were caught off guard. Many are still trying to make sense of this all. In this process, some of us are growing impatient. I'm not here to condemn anyone that are impatient about when are things going to get back to what they used to be. And maybe it might not be able to be that way. We're in a new norm. So there's still a fear inside, still rising, not about the virus, but other things we feel out of control with. What's next? What can we expect in the next coming months? But if I may make a plug here, for the It Is Written series, Hope Awakens. Hope will awaken. There will be hope. And you can watch those series on hopeawakens.org. And I encourage you to. There's a lot of good information on there. And Pastor John Bradshaw is preaching very time-concerning messages. Well, what if fear and panic that is brewing right now, what would that look like? Well, when we have fear and panic that goes unchecked, we want things done when we think they should happen. Or waiting on God becomes a great disservice to us. And we look elsewhere for what we need. Well, the book of Judges shows what could happen if we do that. There's a phrase that is repeated a couple times, three times to be exact, in the book of Judges. And that is, there was no king in Israel, and they did what is right in their own eyes. What drives a person to such a thing? They've experienced God's deliverances, and they did see his powerful display of power. They heard the talents of a mighty God that was told with sincere belief. Stories must have shown God's majesty and inspired a desire for his presence and provision. Yet in the book of Judges, the people have lost sight. How many times did they go away from God where he had to bring up a judge? The end of the book of Judges is basically just saying what has happened throughout the whole book. There was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Maybe the stories lost their impact. The people could have lost interest in telling the stories, or maybe they just took it for granted. Either way, they forsook their way and the way. There's a text that gives us a clue, and I've said it already. What possibly might it happen? There was no king in Israel. And that is repeated three times in Judges 17, 18, skips a chapter, and happens in chapter 20. Now, there is part of the text that is mentioned in chapter 19, where it says, there was no king in Israel. But it leaves out the part, and everyone did, but every man did, that which was right in his own eyes. Leadership was forsaken and given way to personal opinions. They began to depart from slowly till it was said that they did what was right in their own eyes. Hope, the reverse of hope awakenings, was happening. They were caught off guard. And instead of going to God as their king, they followed their own instinct of what should happen. A slippery slope of denial and leadership that set up their own idea of leadership, an earthly king. A king that would rule the nation the way they wanted. A king that would give them their own sense of peace and comfort. A king that was not God. Where would that lead? What would that look like? What would happen if such a decision was made? Well, we know the why. They lost their faith in God. Sermons were just a part of routine of what the priests were sharing. Church service was just what they did and not a source of growth. And so when it wasn't in the church building, many might have forsaken it. when there wasn't an established place for worship, they forsook it. And maybe they lost their faith because the stories of old faded. Memorial miracles were buried under new struggles. And a king like them was desired. Somebody that they could see. Somebody they can feel and touch. But even Samuel, when they came to him and said they wanted a king, said this is not the way. And in 1 Samuel chapter 8, 10 through 18, there's this dialogue about what the king that they would have would do. And it's in 1 Samuel chapter 8. It says, First Samuel 8:10-18. Yeah, get into it right here. Because going out of the Bible, still want to read your Bibles. And it says here, and Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked of him a king. And he said, this will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots, and to be his horsemen. And some shall run before his chariots, and he will appoint him captains over thousands and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots. And he shall take your daughters to be confectionaries and to be cooks and to be bakers. And he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. And he will take the tenth of your seed and of your vineyards and give to his officers and to his servants. And he will take your men servants and your maid servants. So far, it does not sound good, does it? And your goodliest young men and your donkeys, and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your sheep, and you shall be his servants. And ye shall cry out in the day because of your king, which have chosen you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. And their simple response was nay, no. And they said to Samuel, and in the process of saying to Samuel, they're also saying it to God, but we will have a king over us, that we also may be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles. Ignorant to the Lord, they refused to listen. Their opinion became so strong that reason would not be heard. We must learn from this and their rejection of God. If we don't, history will repeat. Has repeated. But will ourselves continue the rejection or promote the Lord as King and God? Where is our stance? Is God King? Some people may say that it wasn't so bad for them to want a king. This was not a rejection of God. Even though the text clearly says in 1 Samuel 8, 7 and 8, that this was the rejection of God. But fast forward, as the kings of Israel start trickling into leadership, some were good for a short time, maybe did good things sparingly. But the majority of the kings, especially of Israel, were bad. And when as I said, the split of the nation, when that happened, and you had Israel in the north and Judah in the south. Well, many kings did not love God, did not honor God. And when that happened, the nation suffered as well. They turned to idol worship of Baal. And as a prominent preacher back in the 1930s, 1940s, a Presbyterian pastor by the name of Peter Marshall mentioned in a sermon called Trial by Fire, Baal was a god of materialism, he puts it, and of the lower based passions. Often we just think of God as the part concerning rain, but there was more than Baal giving rain. They basically sought Baal as a replacement of God, as most and every idol is a replacement of God. So, but it is at truly at Mount Carmel that we see the disturbing display of destitution in the worship of Baal. If you have your Bibles, or I encourage you to pick up your Bible later and read this, it's in the chapter 18 of the book First Kings, found in the Old Testament. Now, much has happened. Elijah was told by God to go to King Ahab, a king of Israel. And he was told to say there was going to be no rain until they repent and acknowledge the Lord as God. Well, we know from reading our scriptures in 1 Kings that it took 3.5 years. 3.5 years. Let that sink in. 3.5 years of no rain. Not one single drop. And the country started to wither up, dry up. The luscious green grass started to look as the burnt brown of a drought. And here, all they had to do was acknowledge the Lord is God. But did they? Sadly, no. They did not. So 3.5 years later, of no rain, Elijah is sent. And he calls them to Mount Carmel, all the people to Mount Carmel, for a challenge. And what happens? Well, that's part of the next part of the sermon here. The nation came to a crippled condition of conscience, and they still worship Baal. There was no end in sight of that worship. And knowing that he was not God, for 3.5 years, Baal, who sends the rain, did not send rain. And it had to be coming into their thoughts. They had to start realizing. Well, when Elijah opens this meeting on Mount Carmel, this conflict, as some people call it, he opens the challenge with this question: how long shall you halt between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him, from 1 Kings 18:21. This time, the people spoke in silence. Maybe some there wanted to answer the question, but the fear of what's next kept them from answering. At this point, they were unsure of what they wanted. Baal wasn't providing rain. and they simply were too afraid to go back to God. Change of some sort was about to happen. But what? Elijah shows Baal, allows the Baal priest to go first. So the Baal priests start their wicked worship service. And it lasts from morning till evening. And I'll spare you the details, but if you go to the book of 1 Kings chapter 18, you will see what exactly they did. And it is very disturbing. So much so that after they are done, the people are seen going afar, going a little, stepping back a little from this wicked worship service, even though they've been part of it for 3.5 years. Well, the only thing that stopped that wicked worship service was the weakness of the torn, bleeding priests. They would have continued, but strength had abated them, and now it was Elijah's turn. At the point of the evening worship service, when the lamb was to be the offering sacrifice of the evening worship was to be done, this is the time Elijah has his turn. And he sits, he builds an altar. And I missed something when I was reading this text so many times. It says that he repaired. He repairs the altar of the Lord and prepares the sacrifice. Which begs the question, are there broken altars in our life that need repair? Has family worship lost its meaning and time? Have your devotions dried up in a drought of dreariness? Elijah said to the people, "Come near unto me." Well, the people were weary and out of strength. It is tiring when God is not the center of your life. Yes, Christians do get tired. I admit, I get tired pretty easily. But the wicked experience a different type of tired. For Revelation says that there is no rest for the wicked. And Jesus makes this appeal in Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30, he says, "Come unto me, all ye that are labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." That offer Jesus mentioned in Matthew 11, still stands today for the Baal worshipers of today. Come unto me. Come unto me. And as Elijah is calling those Baal worshipers to come unto him, and they came forward, so can you come forward. It is never too late. Now Elijah asks for the altar to be drenched with buckets of water. It says 4 barrels of water 3 times. And then I should mention, to the point where the trench that was dug around the altar was full. And then Elijah, in a calm conversational voice, lifts up the prayer, "Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again," which is found in 1 Kings 18:37. king has led them away from the king. Elijah's prayer is his desire for them to know the Lord God. The Lord is God. And God's desire for you is to know him also as God. The word in Carmel in Hebrew means God's vineyard. And Matthew chapter 21, 33 to 40, Jesus gives a parable of a householder creating a vineyard. And he loans it to a group of men and then goes to a far country. When the time for the fruit season comes, he sends servants. And the servant was beaten, killed, and stoned, the servants, in the first two attempts. And the third time, he reasons that if I send my son, they will respect him. But when the son is approaching, the men look at him and say, "There is the son. Let's kill him and take his inheritance." Jesus was speaking of the Pharisees, and the Pharisees knew that he was talking about them. But even after this parable, knowing he was speaking about them, they still sought for the Son of God's life. So as the parable implies, a Hebrew scripture passage in Isaiah chapter 5, verse 4, says, "What could I have done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Wherefore I looked that it should bring forth grapes, bring it forth wild grapes." His desire is to bring fresh grapes, to make you afresh, to give you life abundantly, as Pastor mentioned in one of his sermons. And fire comes down after the prayer of Elijah and consumes the sacrifice prayer prepared. And the evidence this time is so convincingly compelling that the people shout out, "The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God." There's a revival in Israel now. The proclamation is made. There is the realization of the Lord as God. The Mount Carmel experience is a reminder of another mountain experience. That is the occurrence of Mount Sinai. Now, how do you see that? Where do you see that? Well, on Mount Sinai, fire came down as the presence of the Lord. And he established that he is God. Even the first commandment of the Ten Commandments, the first one says, "I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me." A very simple but essential fact. Yet the people of this day, in the time of Mount Sinai, and the Israelites that were at the base of Mount Sinai, as they were hearing the Lord speak out the Ten Commandments, they were afraid and backed off. The people turned their focus to an earthly leader. The expectations were of their own opinion. They didn't want to deal with God. They wanted somebody else to deal with God. They didn't want a close spiritual relationship. They wanted somebody else to be in the middle, a middleman, so to speak. But Moses tried. As he saw how the people backed off Moses tried to calm the people in Exodus 20:20. And it's interesting, 2020, it's always hindsight, right? And we're in the year 2020. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, for God is come to prove you. And that his fear may be before your faces, that ye sin not. God wanted a personal relationship with them all. That's why he spoke to them all in the congregation, so that individually they would make, and not to one leader. Not that a human in leadership is bad, for God set up kings and he takes down kings. He set up leadership in religious places. He set up Aaron as the priest. He did set up Moses as a leader. And he set up the Pharisees as leaders. But these leaders may not always go accordingly to God's purpose. And this is why he desires for us to have a personal relationship with him, that he writes the law on our hearts and on our minds. And he wants us so that we don't have to go and teaching it to each other, but that we will personally know it. So what I'm saying, and I believe the scriptures declare, is that don't forget the Lord, he is God. The book of Judges, they forgot that. They want an earthly king in 1 Samuel 8. There is a problem of the desire of a king in place of our own spiritual lives. And our wanting our own spirit and concerning our own spiritual condition. The statement of Judges didn't just declare that there was no earthly king, but it confirmed the choice to reject God as king. So, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we talk about we are to bring an Elijah message to the world. What is it? What does it look like? Are some of the questions that we need to ask. Elijah asked then, and he asks now, how long shall you halt be crippled between two opinions? Who is God in your life? Is the Lord your God? Or is Baal in some form or matter entered into your religious life and into your life in general? And how does your actions and feelings reflect who is God? Are you impatient? These are questions I'm asking myself. I appeal not only to you, but to me and to all the people that are listening on the radio and all the people on YouTube and to those here on Zoom. I appeal and challenge you to search the scriptures and to find God. Pray for the Holy Spirit and discernment, as we talked about in Sabbath school class. Ask yourself the difficult questions. Where am I spiritually? Is the Lord really God in my life? Many are pushing for America to be converted as a nation. But where are you? Are you converted? 2 months ago, life changed. There is a new normal. What is next? What shall we do? I don't know in the immediate context of these answers. I do know Jesus is coming. So get ready, get ready, get ready. For when you don't know when or what is next, the best thing to do is to pray and prepare. Let's bow our heads for a closing prayer. Dear Jesus, Heavenly Father, Lord, so many people might have heard this story for the first time. I ask that you will continue to lead them closer to you. Lord, some of us may be impatient with what's next. And that is why we need to pray. And that is why we're praying, Lord. We are praying that you will ease our fears of what is next. I'm not praying this just to preach. I'm praying this because, Lord, I sincerely desire this. I sincerely desire that you will help us prepare and that you will lead us closer to you. Whatever is in our path, whatever is in our way, I ask that you will remove it and make a clear, clear decision and proclamation in our own personal lives. Lord, you are God. In your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.